And whoa. Didn't plan on that. Look what somebody brought me this morning. Isn't that sweet? Woo! I get to drool at night now, all right? That is so cool. That is so cool. It's much better than Dodger Blue. But anyway, how about them Giants the last couple of days, huh? Wow, I was just told they won on a freak last night. I missed it. Yeah, runner got hit, and the game ended right there. Yeah, that's pretty cool. Yeah, Yankees won. A-Rod tied Willie Mays. What a week, man. American Pharoah won the Kentucky Derby. Mayweather beat Pacquiao. It was a day yesterday, man. Yeah, not that any of it was all that important, but it was, you know, very interesting. All right, very interesting. Who? Oh, yeah, the princess was born. Yeah. I missed that one. Thanks for sharing. That's good. All right. We're giving Beto a little time because he had a little glitch back there. I'm getting a heads up there. But let's highlight the trip that we went. I can't believe all that's happened in a week. All right. I went from being in a rodeo on Sunday to Washington, D.C. for 3 days. To all I talked about that happened yesterday, and there's a whole lot more on top of that. But anyway, it's hard to believe that all that's taking place in just, you know, 7 days. But Dad, where are you? Dad, Phil, stand up. All right? Here's our two veterans that made it all the way to D.C. and back. No injuries, no hurts. We are so, so grateful for them. Woo! The rest of you may be seated. No, Phil and Dad, remain standing. Phil and Dad, stand up. You two remain standing. And guys, you're going to have to quit this with them because they're starting to feel like they're rock stars. All right? I mean, we would walk through the various memorials, the veterans and the Korean, and people would just part the waters for them and applaud as they went by. And it was awesome. Kids from elementary age all the way through high school would run up to them and shake their hand and thank them for their service. It was incredible to watch. And then we get home, and there's this huge party in the airport. Chip, Dad was hugging all the cheerleaders, all right? I mean, but it was just absolutely incredible. People putting cameras, you know, in front of their face, and it was awesome. Phil, I'm going to save you for last in this service, all right? Dad, how was your 3 days in D.C.?
It was awesome.
Good. Are you glad you went?
Yes.
Would you do it again if you'd never been before?
I'd do it again.
All right. Terrific. One highlight. What was your highlight?
I was in Memorial Land, changing of the guard and the cemetery.
Yeah, the changing of the guard at Arlington Cemetery. And we had a little special treat there. How many of you remember Sam's luggage here in Fresno? Okay, Samuel, Mr. Samuelin. He was on this trip, and his nephew is a Commodore in the Navy, who's also a Navy SEAL, who's also stationed at the Pentagon. And the hotel we stayed in was right across from the Pentagon, so he walked over the first day we were there and ended up following us everywhere we went, and the next day rode with us. And let me tell you, when you show up to Arlington Cemetery with all the personnel who are there, when they see a Commodore with a Navy SEAL patch, everybody gives him attention. So we got a few little extra goodies at that site that you don't normally get because we had a Navy SEAL Commodore with us. Phil, yes, did you enjoy the trip?
I had a fantastic time. I could not believe it. We got off airplane, and who did I see but my daughter from Colorado? Aww. I get a little emotional.
It's okay.
And my niece and her grandson. It was unbelievable.
Yeah, it was, wasn't it, Phil? It was terrific. Thank you, guys. At the next senior luncheon, at the senior luncheon in June and at the men's breakfast in June, Gene has made arrangements for both of those men to be the keynote guests and speakers at both of those events. Some of you who are 55 and older but have never wanted to admit you were a senior, you probably will show up to that one now, and that'll be okay. And at the men's breakfast, we'll have some pictures and show it. Phil also had the privilege of having his granddaughter be his companion, his guardian, and his great-grandson was part of the media. He is a journalist and photographer at Fresno Christian, and so they let him go as part of the media. And he got a media seat on the bus and on the airplane, and it was just a very, very rewarding trip. And so we're very grateful for that. Well, welcome to New Hope today. We've kind of got a different morning for you today, so I think you're going to enjoy it. Let me highlight a few things, and then we'll get engaged in our worship. If you are visiting New Hope today for the first time, you honor us with your presence. There is a guest card in the pew in front of you. I'd love for you to take it out, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by. Next week through the mail, we'll send you information that tells you about the church. Promise we're not going to beat on your door or pester you, but we'd love to get some information in your hand about New Hope Church. Let me highlight a few things coming up. In case you forgot, next Sunday is Mother's Day. All right? So don't forget that. And there's a couple of ways in which you can engage in that process. Number one, why don't you write a letter to your mom and get it here to the church by this Wednesday? Now, you can get it to your mom by Sunday, but get a copy of a letter that you wrote in 100 words or less, whether your mother is still with you or whether your mom is in heaven already. What would you like to say to her on this Mother's Day? Drop that off here at the church office. Nick is going to read them. He's going to use them in some form or fashion, and he's going to present an award next Sunday morning, all right, for the one that was most powerful to him. So it'll be a special way for us to kick off our Mother's Day. Tim Kepler will be leading worship on Mother's Day. He's back from Japan, just got back a day or two ago, and he will be leading worship. And Milo, so I don't forget this, what I would love for him to be able to do, if you could let him know, is kind of get rehearsal underway well enough. I would like him to sneak over to 8 o'clock service and just do one special number on Mother's Day for our 8 o'clock crowd. Okay? Great. Thank you. Mother's Day corsages will be available. We've done this for years. They're $9 for a corsage. This goes to provide support for our Right to Life ministries that are here in the Fresno area that offer alternatives to young women who are looking for alternatives in a very difficult situation. We plan on having also, if they get delivered to us in time, the baby bottles, which we also use to support some very, very important decision-making that goes on in the community. It's called Change for Babies. You take a baby bottle on Mother's Day, you fill it up with change, you bring it back on Father's Day. If you just don't like change, they take dollar bills as well. They take checks inside it. But you take it on Mother's Day, return it by Father's Day, and it goes for a very, very worthy cause. Our small group directors, leaders, are putting on a special movie night. You don't have to be part of a small group to come to movie night, but it's one of the ways in which we can get as many of our small group folks together on a particular evening. So come for a special movie. It's on the 30th of May. And group number two is asking for two things. They're kind of leading the charge. I do have more information about the underwear thing. Preferably all of you wear it that night, but the key is they want you to bring packages of new underwear. So let me clarify that. We don't want used. We want new. And it can be any size, for any age, and for both genders. Okay? So we got all that cleared up. We had a lot of confusion last week. Or at least I was confused last week, but it's all been clarified now. Group two also would like to challenge every small group to bring desserts, make homemade desserts, and the crowd that night will decide which dessert they like the best. All right? And here's the deal. We're not selling the desserts. We're not raising money for anything. You just get to eat them. All right? You just get to eat them. And that's the best kind of night. So that's going on. You see some pictures in your bulletin. You're going to see some pictures up on the screen here in the offertory about our Mexico mission trip, so please pay attention to that. Senior luncheon coming up in May. That's on May the 12th, so put that down. Please take the opportunity to check all the other dates that are there. Let me highlight a few prayer requests. Marianne, Lisa's mom, is no longer responsive over these last 3 days. She has stopped eating, stopped drinking, and now has stopped responding. Spent some time there Friday afternoon, so did Jean. And so just continue to remember to pray for Lisa and her family and Marianne. Last time I saw her and she was responsive, she assured me, Tim, I am not afraid. I am ready. And when she does become responsive, the first one she'll respond to will be the Lord Jesus himself. And that's an incredible prospect. So continue to remember to pray for them. Polly Good is home and is recuperating from her surgery at Stanford. Carol Gill, she's now a rock star too. She told me she's made it all the way to Wales, all right, with the news release that was done. And I think that maybe the best thing I heard out of all of that is that the county insurance commissioner is wanting to reach out and hopefully has contacted you already. If not, three phone calls. Great. So we hope there is some improvement in that particular area. That would be awesome. And Helen Heath, I don't see her today. Continue to a bullet. Okay. Amen. Amen. That was on Wednesday, right? All right. Terrific. I want to take a couple of minutes to share an experience I had yesterday that ranks up there in a top 10 moment. I think the discouraging part for me was this event has been going on for about 3 years in Fresno County, and I didn't know anything about it. I was asked by Roy Bell, the owner of Bell Memorial behind Clovis Cemetery, does headstones. I was asked by Roy if I could participate in a special service at Mountain View Cemetery. He asked me this about 2 weeks ago, and kind of gave me a little background. I went online and I Googled Garden of Innocence. Garden of Innocence is out at Mountain View. This got started out of San Diego when a woman discovered a problem and she wanted to be part of the solution. In most counties in the United States, there is a law that says if you carry a baby past 20 weeks and it either dies or you have abortion after 20 weeks, you still are legally bound to take appropriate care of burial for your child. Now, it's interesting, you can have an abortion. Well, they don't call it viable life, but yet if it's 20 plus weeks, you have to care for it as if it's viable life. That's a fascinating contradiction in my brain. And what often happens, and you can't know the circumstances about each of these babies. Nobody can know anything. But all you can know is they are known as abandoned children. So they either were aborted after 20 weeks, stillborn after 20 weeks, and the parents never got them from the coroner. They just abandoned them. They made no arrangements. Counties differ on the length. Some counties it's 30 days, some counties it's 60 days. But if family doesn't take care of these children, then the county disposes of them, usually in a mass way. Either they're cremated and their ashes are scattered at sea just by county personnel, or they are buried in a pauper's area, no name, unnamed, often collectively in a group. A lady heard about this in San Diego, and she put into motion a nonprofit organization. She went to her county, took a while to get it done, and she worked with a funeral home, she worked with a cemetery, got a lot of volunteers, and so she finally was able to get arrangements where the county, when they hit the date of abandonment, that instead of them handling it in a very calloused way, they will turn over those babies to the Garden of Innocence organization. The Garden of Innocence does a couple of things. Number one, first thing they do is they give each baby a name. Second thing they do is they make arrangements for a burial and a service. Funeral homes cooperate. Cemetery cooperates. Beautiful area at Mountain View has been fenced in. It's taken care of. It's just lovely. Roy got involved because he provides all the headstones. They had a service Saturday morning. It's announced in various ways, but I'd never heard it before. There were about 140 people probably there yesterday. They said they've had as many as 350. We buried five babies yesterday. And the way they do this is representatives from each of the funeral homes in the area carry a small box. Okay, it's a beautiful boxed urn. And the name of the baby is on it. Everybody who's present makes a big circle around the Garden of Innocence. And then they pass each one of these babies. It passes through every one of our hands. That baby now has touched every one of our lives. And then they're placed on a table next to a beanie baby. And that beanie baby will be buried with them. And then there is a service. There is music. I spoke. There is the display of the petals, where rose petals are dropped at the site where these babies are being born. And these babies will be buried. There'll be a headstone with their name and the date of their birth on them. And what a remarkable way to give honor and dignity to some in our community who would be absolutely forgotten. So I want you to do a favor with me today. I'm going to call out one name at a time. There are five names. And you see, I personally believe that those five babies are already with their Creator. And the Scripture says in Hebrews chapter 12, we are surrounded by this great cloud of witnesses. And so I would love for five of those witnesses to hear their names in heaven from earth. And so I'm going to say a name, and I want you to say it after that with me, so these five babies can touch your life as well as they touch mine. Francis.
Francis.
Stephen.
Stephen.
Ted.
Ted.
Who gives a kid the name Ted anymore? That was my father-in-law's name, but I mean, who names their kids Ted anymore? I don't know who came up with that name. There's Teddy, but Teddy's different. Teddy's not Ted. Ted is not Theodore, all right? Most Teds are Theodore. Ted is not a Theodore, all right? Carter.
Carter.
And this last one, this is another one. Benji.
Benji.
Yeah, those were the five children that we celebrated and honored yesterday. And so here's what I've asked the director for the Garden of Innocence in Fresno County to now do, is we are now on their email list. And so before they have another service, we will know about it, and I will be able to let you know about it. And I'll be honest, I expect for there to be several of us at the next service, all right? Because I think that is a wonderful testimony to others in our community, that we care and we're compassionate. And man, if we're talking about the least of these, those have been considered by some to not even count. And I want them to know they count. That was a very, very challenging day yesterday. Well, I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward, wait on us for our tithes and our offering. And this morning, oh, look at this, husband and wife. Okay. Oh, look at this. We got a pair, two pair. All right. I direct your attention to the screen because you're going to see the video presentation of the Mexico mission trip, and then followed by that, you are going to hear a special music from someone who has never sung special music at New Hope before, and I am awed. I think this is incredible, and he's going to be accompanied by his daughter, which is even better. Let's pray. Father, thanks for the life that you share with us. Thank you for the opportunities of living life that you share with us. Opportunities like the Garden of Innocence moment yesterday, which when I was first asked, it sure, I'll help you out. And oh, wow. How selfish of me it was to even think that thought. Because I was changed as a result of yesterday. I'll never be the same. So, Father, thank you for those surprise moments where you catch us off guard. And you do your good work in us. Father, I trust you with the needs of those who've been through surgery and treatment this past week and are home recovering. I share with you their needs, Lord, for Bill, who's at VA hospital, an uncle to Wanda Wood in our 8 o'clock service, 87, got pneumonia, other complications. We trust you with his needs. For Marianne, Father, we're going to be saying, see you later, and you're going to be saying hello to her very, very soon. And we trust you with the needs surrounding that. We trust you with the family's needs. Give them a strength and an uncommon peace over these next few days. Father, for the privilege of giving and sharing, we say thanks. I trust that in today's service, you will find men and women who will allow you to do business in their heart. For out of the heart is where the issues of life are settled. And I pray today, we will allow you in a progressive way to do more and more transformation in us than we've granted permission to you before. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We have seen the pain.
did you ever get that picture? Hey, throw that picture up if you would, real quick. There's a picture of Dad and Phil, and that is at one small section of the World War II Memorial. The World War II Memorial is the largest of all the memorials. It's very, very large. There are columns that go in a football-shaped circle around a pool, and each of those columns will have the name of a state on it. So all 50 states are represented, and then you have this gigantic pool in the middle with fountains that come out of it. And on the backside, just to the right of where they're standing, there is another smaller pool, and on the back wall of that pool are gold stars. And every one of those gold stars, I wrote this down, and my memory's failing me, every one of those gold stars, I believe, represents the death of 100 U.S. soldiers. We lost in World War II over 403,000 citizens in the United States, second only to the Civil War, where both sides were citizens of the U.S. And so that is reflected there. Unlike the Vietnam Memorial, where the names are listed by year and by location, you just would not have enough room to put 400,000 plus names. And so they did a beautiful job, and that picture was taken there. Right after that picture was taken, Phil's daughter from Colorado presented him with a beautiful quilt that she had made just for him, and with things that kind of came out of that period of time that were personal to him. And they also presented Dad with a quilted wall hanging, all right, that said to Pops and talked about his time of service that was there. And so that was a very, very special moment on the trip. Thank you. Thank you for doing that, Milo. Okay. Let me make one quick disclaimer. So those of you who were here last week, is anybody too cold in here? Okay, if you would maybe turn off the side coolers and just leave the middle ones on, that would be great. I know if I'm really comfortable, you all are probably a little cold. So I thought I would ask. Just so some of you who were here last week don't think I've lost my mind, I realize the story that I'm about to tell at the beginning of this sermon is the very same story I told at the end of last week's sermon. I know that. Just hang with me, okay? I didn't want you to think I'm slipping a little bit more than you already think. All right. His name is Bill. His hair is wild. He wears t-shirts with holes in them, jeans, and no shoes or sandals. This was literally Bill's wardrobe for his entire 4 years of college. He's intelligent, kind of esoteric, and very, very bright. He became a Christian while attending college. Across the street from the campus is a well-dressed, very conservative, probably Baptist church. They wanted to develop a ministry to college students, but they weren't sure how to go about it. One day, Bill decides he's going there. He walks into church a little late, no shoes, jeans, t-shirt with holes in it, and wild hair. The service had already started, so Bill starts down the center aisle looking for the closest seat he can find. The church is completely packed, and he can't find a seat. He keeps coming down the center aisle towards the front. By now, people are really looking a bit uncomfortable with Bill. No one says anything. Bill gets closer to the front, closer to the pulpit, and when he realizes there are no seats, he just plops down right on the carpet, right in front of the pulpit. Now, that was perfectly acceptable behavior for college fellowships, but this had never happened in this church. By now, the people are really uptight. That's why it's probably Baptist. And the tension in the air is thick. About this time, the pastor realizes that from way in the back of the church, his oldest deacon is slowly making his way towards Bill. The deacon is in his 80s, silver gray hair, three-piece suit, godly man, very elegant, very dignified, very courtly. He walks with a cane, and as he starts walking towards this young man, everybody in the congregation is saying to themselves, uh-oh, this is going to be awkward. But you can't blame him. How can you expect a man of his age and his background to understand some college kid? It takes a long time for that elderly deacon to reach the young man. The Church is now utterly silent, except for the clicking of the man's cane. All eyes are focused on him. The preacher can't even start his sermon until the deacon does what the deacon needs to do. And now everybody observes as this elderly man drops his cane on the floor, puts his hand on Bill's shoulder, and with great difficulty he lowers himself into a cross-legged position right next to Bill, and he begins to lift his hands to worship so that Bill would not worship alone. Everybody choked up with emotion, and when the minister finally gained control of his own voice, he says, "What I'm about to preach to you this morning, you will never remember, but what you have just seen, you will never forget." Last Sunday, at the end of this service, Jerry, who's sitting right there, actually, I think it was the end of the last service last week, Jerry came up to me and said, "Tim, do you know the rest of the story? Buf used to tell that one." And I said, "Remind me in case I forgot." Here's the rest of the story. Someone asked the elderly deacon after that service was over. He said, "I noticed you leaned over and whispered something to that college kid's ear. What did you say to him?" The old deacon said, "I whispered, 'Next week before you come to church, ask God what would be appropriate attire.'" The following Sunday, Bill shows up, dressed the very same way. And the deacon said to Bill, "I thought I told you to ask God what was appropriate attire to wear to church." And Bill said, "I did." And the elderly deacon says, "Well, what did he tell you?" And Bill replied, "God told me I haven't been in that church for so long, I have no idea what appropriate attire is." That was good, so I thought I needed to tell you the rest of the story today. If I could summarize what we've been talking about for the last couple of weeks, and what we've been talking about the last couple of weeks is what we've been talking about for the 30 weeks before that. What I wanted to do is to try to create this idea of transformation. I want you to take these 30 separate issues, and somehow I want you to see in your own mind how these 30 things come together. And they're designed by God to bring a real sense of harmony, of transformation into all of our lives. That this just wasn't a series. This needs to be a way of life for us. What is it that we think about and know that is on the mind of God? These 10 foundational doctrines is a foundation that you and I, we need to know all 10 of these. And it's not restricted to only these 10. This is where it starts, though. These are the key building blocks to your life. You need to know them and why they're important. And once you know them, then those truths should bring about action in our part. It should produce these actions. And when you and I have blended together what we should know with what we should do, we now have created an environment where God can do in us what He's always wanted us to do. We can now be who He intended us to become by reflecting in our life these 10 virtues that are a reflection of the character of God Himself, Christ in us, the hope of glory. And so I wanted to take a few weeks to try to emphasize the importance of those 30 things becoming reality in our life. And I thought last week, if I could take all of that and summarize it in one sentence, how could I try to capture the thrust and importance of what they mean? And for me, here's a personal summary of kind of what I've been trying to say the last 2 weeks. I want the intent of my choices. I want the intent of my choices to reflect that I care about God and that I trust Him with everything in my life. And some of you are saying, "Why didn't you just say that? We all could have gone home so much sooner." Because I want us to apply that. I want that to become a reality for all of us. So 2 weeks ago, we talked about this process of transformation. We've called it the revolution of our life. All right? And so in order for this revolution of our life to begin, in order for transformation to get started, what is the absolute first essential that must happen? God! Yeah, good job! All right, your memory wasn't very good last week, but it's better this week. Yeah, it starts with these first two. We must believe, first of all, there is a God, and then this God who is, he must become personal to us. It takes God in us to start this transformation, this process of revolution in our life. We must know that we have the presence of God within us. And the second thing then that happens is once we have the presence of God in us, now we have to begin to think about the truths of God. That's where this comes in. We have to have a transformation of our mind. We need to put into here the essence of these foundational truths. The Bible says the truth, in knowing the truth, it will set us free. It will give God the opportunity to transform us because he has the freedom to exercise his life in us. If we want to progressively become more like Christ, if we want to be lumps of clay that are molded into the image of the potter, then we must progressively embrace the mindset of Jesus Christ. What is it that Jesus believed? What is it that Jesus taught? Here it is. After the presence of God in us, we add think to the process. This is not just some intellectual pursuit, but rather it is adopting the state of mind of Christ in us. Paul said it this way, let this mind which was in Christ Jesus also be in you. As we belong, as we grow, as we serve, we are becoming, and we start to think as Jesus would have us think, and this leads us to serve others as we serve him. External virtue flows from an internal well of belief. Once we have God's presence in us and we begin to feed our mind the truths of God's word, we have a developing understanding of the mind of Christ and we take the next step. Folks, this is essential. People without the presence of God in them can be trained to live a better life, but they cannot be transformed. By law and legislation, they can be trained. But guess what, folks? We have a law that says if you have a baby born, even if it's stillborn, after 20-plus weeks of pregnancy, you have a responsibility to care for it. We have a law. And without the presence of God inside of you, what do people do? They ignore the law. See, we obey the laws that are convenient for us. We obey the laws that by restrictions, I don't want to go to prison, so I won't do that. I might want to do that, but I don't do that. And here's the difference. God changes our want to. I remember as a little kid hearing a lot of preachers, my dad included, say, you know what, after you become a Christian, you can do whatever you want to. But after you become a Christian, you won't want to. It's pretty simple, but pretty much right on. But that's the process of transformation. Shelly and I, we have this great dog now. His name's Max. Okay? Max is a Llewellyn setter. Got him at 5 years old. I got him right after I got back from Africa. I'd been wanting one of these. Thanks to Danny. Found one for me. Went and picked it up out of Porterville. I don't know if he's going to be worth anything when I get him in the field, all right? Particularly after Shelly keeps spoiling him at home, all right? My neat freak wife, all right? She opens the door and lets this long-haired dog in. Why? Because he goes right to the rug that's his rug, and he lays right down. He puts his head on his paws, and he kind of looks out of one eye, hoping that nobody notices him, and he'll get to stay in the whole night, all right? He thinks he's kind of hiding, right? He's quiet. He doesn't get up. He's never messed up in the house, okay? He's been house trained. But here's what I know. He's house trained, but he's not transformed. Because I know if I leave him in the house too long, he's not going to go in the bathroom and lift the lid. I know that because he hadn't been transformed. He's just been trained. So I know that I'm going to have to eventually go open a door, or that dog's training is going to go out the window and he's going to do what instinctively he knows to do. And that is you and I, without the presence of God in us and without the truths of God's word in us, we might train the flesh. But you see, transformation is external virtues that come from an internal well of belief. This works from the inside out, not the outside in. So the presence of God, the revolution of our mind, that leads us to the revolution of actions Beliefs produce action if we really believe them. Otherwise, it's just a list. If we believe them, we'll obey them. We practice our faith. When we observe the life of Jesus, we notice that he practiced a series of spiritual disciplines in his own life, in his relationship with his Heavenly Father and with other people. This illustration now contains the word act. We think and then we act to show our movement and our revolution in our relationship with God. The mindset of the truth of Christ in us leads to action of Christ through us. And all this is brought about by and through the presence of God in us. The practices that Jesus modeled and taught are things like worship and prayer and scripture memory. Now I realize Jesus had one advantage on the scripture memory part. He wrote it. Easy to remember what you've written, all right? But he still, Jesus, many times through his earthly ministry, preached and he quoted Old Testament scripture. He would serve the needs of the poor. He would give away time to help others in need. He prioritized his life according to God, his Father's agenda. He even submitted to the act of total surrender in his life. We're offered to move the teachings of Jesus from our head to our heart. And this is what it means to obey everything that Jesus commanded in Matthew 28, 19 and 20. That passage says, go into all the world and preach the gospel. And verse 20 then says, obeying all things that I have commanded you. The all things. If we want the nutrients of Christ to pump from our hearts, from our head to our hearts, from our heart to our hands and feet, mouths and attitudes, we must remain in Jesus and keep his commands. Through faith in Christ, we are promised eternal life in God's kingdom. Key truth number 10, all right, the last one of these is what? Eternity. Yeah, that key truth, that belief is a life changer, folks. That one is a life changer. If we truly believe this from our heart, it will produce in our lives this amazing virtue of hope. As I set foot at the Garden of Innocence yesterday and I realized all that was about to happen, and my heart broke until this dawned on me. What happened was sad. But the end result is those abandoned babies on earth were not abandoned in eternity. And that gives us hope. That gives us hope. At least they were here. And I'm glad they are there. Twyla Paris wrote, this is not on my agenda. Let me go there. I can pull this up. Twyla Paris wrote a great, great piece. It's on my iPad. It is. Trust me. Here we go. Listen to what she wrote. She didn't write it for a service like this. This was a song she wrote. I'd love to find the history to it, but listen to what she wrote. I shared this yesterday at the outset of this service. A visitor from heaven, if only for a while, the gift of love to be returned, we think of you and smile. A visitor from heaven accompanied by grace, reminding of a better love and of a much better place. With aching hearts and empty arms, we send you with a name. It hurts so much to let you go, but we're so glad you came. A visitor from heaven, if only for a day. We thank him for the time he gave, and now it's time to say, we trust you to our Father's love and to his tender care, held in your everlasting arms, and we're so glad you're there. With aching hearts and with open hands, we send you with a name. It hurts so much to let you go, but we're so glad you came. Do you see the difference that an eternal perspective gives to us? In a moment of sadness, in a moment when your eyes just want to flow with tears, God says, hey, I got them covered. I got them covered. They're with me now. And we can do that with every one of our relatives who know Jesus. But guys, this is where, and I got to figure out how to get back to where I left. Hold on. I can do this. I can. I really can. If I don't, I got a retiring youth pastor who can figure it out for me. All right. I'll find my place. Don't worry, but don't sweat about this. Here we go. Okay, here we are. Game changer. Does that illustrate for you how this doctrine number 10 is a life changer and a game changer? Man, here's why. It's because no matter what we face in this life, even the prospect of death, we can live with hope while facing the most difficult situations. Why? Because in the end, we win. We win. Hope is what the world needs to see bucket loads of. And folks, they're not going to see hope in your life when your life is going great. This is where you got to ask yourself the question, am I progressively growing in my life? Is there more hope in your life today than there was 32 weeks ago when we started this series? Is there more hope in your life today than there was 6 years ago when you first gave your life to Jesus Christ? There ought to be. If not, your heart's not right. Your heart. Out of the heart proceeds the issues of life. That was illustrated to me very, very recently. I got a call a few weeks ago. Nobody in this church, so don't try to think, wonder who it was. A couple I married 24 years ago. Probably haven't seen them 5 times since I married them. I get a call and they said, we're in trouble. I said, okay. Come to the office, call, make an appointment. Let's talk about it. Came to see me, first question I asked him, I knew him well enough back then to ask this question. I said, first thing I want to know is, tell me how your relationship with Christ is. Oh yeah, we were doing okay. They kind of both went through a series of things. And I said, okay, it's good to hear. So that's a basis we can work from then. Talked about several of the things. They left, made an appointment for them to come back in 2 weeks, and we'd kind of catch up. Now, one of the crises is the husband in this relationship, he's on leave from his job. Ran into a crisis. He was put on paid administrative leave, waiting for a very important decision. He might lose his career. Okay? Came back to see me a couple of weeks later. He's much happier. He's much more cheery, much less stressed. I said, did you have your hearing? He said, yeah. He's a big smile on his face. I said, it looks like it went good. Tell me about it. He says, well, it's not 100% guaranteed, but everything went my way. I'm feeling much better. I said, tell me about your relationship with Jesus. He said, you asked me that 2 weeks ago. Tell me again. He told me, I said, you're lying to yourself. I shouldn't tell you guys this because now nobody's going to want to come see me again. I said, you're not being honest. He said, what do you mean? I said, here's what a progressively growing relationship with Jesus Christ looks like. You still have joy and you still have peace and you still have contentment when the news is bad. Huh? I said, you have friends and family who you've told you are Christian, right? Yeah. They see you smile now because you got good news. They see you less stressed because you got great news. Where was the hope when you didn't have any news? I said, see, this relationship with Jesus Christ that you've had for 20 plus years, I wouldn't have talked to him like this if he'd been a Christian for 6 months. This is a guy who's been a Christian for over 20 years. And guys, this walk with Jesus Christ is not just an insurance policy for the day I die. This relationship with Jesus Christ is to be functional in the here and now. At this moment, eternal life is ours. At this moment, the hope of eternity is ours. That is why this is such a game changer. If you really believe that in the end we win, really, what difference does it make if you got the bad news at this meeting? The God who got you the last job can't get you another job? How many times have we thought the worst thing in our life just happened and we find out 3 weeks later, the best thing in my life just happened? And the best thing couldn't have happened without the worst thing. Do I need to illustrate any more? On a Friday, the worst thing happened? And on a Sunday, the best thing happened? What was Jesus' response in both of those? Father, you know personally, I'd like a different plan, but I'll trust yours. And he went to the cross, content. That's the Christian life as it's progressively growing and maturing. Okay, I spent too long there, so let me see where I'm going to jump ahead to. Our goal is to become like Christ. To become like Jesus, we must think like Him so that we can act like Him. To act like Jesus from the heart, we must think like Jesus in the mind. We must practice the spiritual life consistently. As we do these amazing truths, these beliefs move from head to heart. When they arrive in our heart, out of which we live, real change happens. Our heart is that mysterious, wonderful, confusing part of us that enables us to love and to laugh and to fear and to experience life. It is that sphere in which relationships happen. It is that sphere in which relationships are broken. And folks, I don't need to tell you this, so I'll just remind you of it. Life can be hard on the heart. The world is full of outside influences that have power to disrupt the rhythm of the heart. Dad, because of his age, has an issue with the rhythm of his heart. And so the doctors gave him a pacemaker. With that pacemaker, his heart is in perfect rhythm. He was almost sprinting at some of those memorials in D.C. Hey. God gives to us, at the moment of our salvation, a pacemaker. It is the person of the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity, who comes to live within our human spirit. That when we put into our minds the truth of God, and in the will of our hearts we say, I will submit to those truths, then the Holy Spirit puts a pace, a rhythm to our heart, to where the character of Christ is produced in and through us. Over time, we develop habits, if we're not careful, that slowly erode our heart's sensitivity to the movement of God in us. The inevitable pain and disappointment that life can bring cause us to build walls in our heart. And much of this is understandable. But at the end of the day, there's no way around this truth. Our heart is out of sync with the rhythm that God created it to maintain. So what are we going to do about that? Empowered by the Spirit alone. Excuse me, let me say that differently. Our own commitment alone is not enough to overcome temptation by our sin-filled, selfish hearts. And this is where point number one is essential. The presence of God in us is the power so that we can think and act and be in this revolution of our lives. God has established His presence within us so we can overcome the power of our own flesh. In the book of Romans, Paul powerfully states this when he said, there is no condemnation to those who are in Jesus Christ, because through Christ, the Spirit of the law who gives life has set us free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do because it's weakened by the flesh, what the law could not train us to do, like a master trains a dog to do, God did by sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh so He could be the right sin offering for us. And by doing that, He condemned sin in the flesh. Why? To give the righteous requirement satisfaction so it could be met in us who do not live according to the flesh any longer, but now we live by the Spirit. Those who live according to the flesh, listen to this, those who live according to the flesh have their minds set on what the flesh wants. But those who live according to the Spirit, capital S, have their mind set on what the Spirit, capital S, desires. Where's your mindset? Where is your mind set? The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. You see, without Christ, we are condemned and we have no choice but to reside in the flesh. Our minds will only make selfish decisions. Our actions can only be that of the flesh. When Christ enters our lives, a new spirit and a new way is introduced. We now have the choice to not live in bondage to the flesh, but to resist it. We no longer live under the shroud of condemnations. Our mind can choose the Spirit. Our hearts can reflect the Spirit. Our actions can display. Here it is. The character of Christ in our life. Can we still choose to be ruled by the flesh? Yes. Go read Galatians chapter 5, the verses before this. But we now have the power and the motivation to choose Christ, His mind, His heart, His actions in us. Once again, we see the importance and centrality of the presence of God in our lives. This revolution of becoming. God wants us to get this think, act, and be revolution turning in our life. And once it's turning, it should never ever stop. It is an ongoing process all the way into eternity. He wants us to be more and more like Christ for His glory and for our own benefit. He wants us to experience joy and peace and hope daily, but He wants and desires us to be more like Jesus, not only for our benefit, but for the sake of others as well. He wants us to be more like Christ for the benefit of our spouse, for our children, for our friends, for our neighbors, for our co-workers, for other church members in the fellowship. The vision of belonging in the Christian community is special. It's not just a group of people who gather frequently or even get together simply to support a good cause. It is a gathering of people who treat each other like Jesus would treat others if He were in the room. And in reality, He is residing in you, so He is actually in the room. And that's the point. A few questions. Would you rather spend time with a person who gives you grace to make mistakes or a person who keeps score on every single move you make? Let me flip that question around. Are you the kind of person who keeps score? Or are you the kind of person who gives grace? Or are you the kind of person that says, depends? Depends on how the other person in the room treats me. Jesus never asked that question. Would you rather hang out with people who are filled with joy about life than one who's down and negative on everything? Would you rather hang out with whining and complaining, or would you rather be with encouragement and rejoicing? Would you rather be down on life or up with life? Would you rather live in the present, or do you still want to live in the past? And just a side note, folks, today is God's presence. Today is His present. God wants us to be joy-filled, hope-filled people for others. Such is His call on our life, for such is our mission and our central purpose. We need the power of God's presence dwelling in the core of our lives. As we yield our will and heart and spirit to God's, He takes control, just like liquid spirits would do with bad outcomes. God's Spirit does with good outcomes. When an entire community of believers is unified with the mindset of Christ, not only is this an ideal place to belong, but a revolution is created that draws others to long to belong with us as well. Let me close with a story. I can do this. On April 28th, 1999. Okay, is anybody getting hot now? Okay, I am. So maybe give me one cooler, okay? They got it back there. They got it, Milo. April 28th, 1999, just 8 days after the Columbine shooting, shock rock singer Marilyn Manson was scheduled to perform a concert in Iowa City. Since Manson music was prominent in the lives of the Columbine killers Eric Harris and Dylan Klebold, there was a lot of emotion surrounding this concert. Mark Forstrom, a local youth minister in the area, wrote about what happened. He wrote, "The police, the media, and the community began to prepare for angry protests and ugly brawling between Christians and Marilyn Manson supporters. Suddenly, something totally unexpected happened. Emerging through the vehicle of email, another local movement suddenly sprang up. The only way to truly change our moral climate is to soften hard hearts." You see, the hearts of Manson fans have been hardened by their perception that Christians are mean-spirited, hateful, and judgmental. Thus, the idea was birthed to unravel the stereotype by encouraging Christians to show the pure love of Christ to those fans in some really tangible ways. Concert day arrived, tension filled the community, media geared up for an ugly battle between the Manson fans and the Christian opposition. Instead, what they observed was an amazing testament to the power and the love of Christ. Scores of Christians from churches all over Linn County, as far away as Des Moines, 2 hours away, converged on the sidewalk outside the Five Seasons Center, not to protest, but to do two things: to pray and to show love. What a sight it was to behold. Groups conducted prayer walks around the arena. People prayed in huddles on the sidewalk. Churches around the city held special prayer gatherings in their own congregations. As for showing love to the fans, one church purchased 100 pizzas, and they freely gave away pieces of pizza to fans in line and bystanders. Cookies and over 1,200 cans of soda were purchased, donated, and distributed. Someone made turkey and cheese sandwiches and passed them out. One pastor asked Manson fans who passed by him, "How can I pray for you today?" About 20 different fans shared specific things. And right there on the spot, they were prayed for. After the concert, over $200 in cash that had been collected by a local youth group was given to patrons to pay for their parking on the way out of the parking lot. The Christians involved said, "We're Christians and would like to show you God's love by paying for your parking tonight." The immediate results of this love and action were phenomenal. People continually asked, "Why are you doing this?" And then they stayed to listen to the answer. Two live radio reporters, one inside, one outside the stadium, discussed on air how preferable it was to be outside with the generous Christians than it was inside with the rockers. At least three people gave their lives to Christ that night. At least one other fan that we know of chose not to go to the concert. He ended up coming to church the following Sunday. After getting pizza, one kid commented, "Wow, Marilyn Manson never gave me anything." A Marilyn Manson website reporting on our Christian response admitted, "So maybe those Christians aren't so bad after all." Before I wrap this up, here's just a thought. You probably don't like Marilyn Manson. You probably hate this kind of music. What would your response been perceived to be like had you been outside that theater that day? As for the concert itself, they wrote, "We saw God work a miracle as well. After only 1 hour, Manson abruptly ended the concert early. He threw his microphone down on the stage in a rage. He stormed off the stage and he never returned." So to summarize the totality of Marilyn Manson's visit to Cedar Rapids, we might say this. Many fans came to the concert convinced that Christians were irritating and Marilyn Manson was impressive. And many left the concert feeling that Marilyn Manson was irritating and that Christians were impressive. Think of how much closer to the kingdom thousands of kids might be as a result of the unforeseen outreach event. Because the heart was revealing to others the character of Christ. The individual revolution of becoming creates the communal revolution of belonging within the church. Our personal think, act, and be revolution begins when we long to be like Jesus. And because we belong to Jesus, this truth and this challenge set up our reflections for applying these principles to our own lives. Let me close by asking a question. How are things with your heart? I'm not asking you how your career is. I'm not asking you how your family is. I'm not asking you how your finances are. What I'm asking this morning is, how's your heart? Chances are you've never stopped to consider your heart. And why should you? I mean, there are meals to fix and calls to return and interviews to prepare for and bills to pay. And if at the end of the day you're caught up on all these things and somebody says, "Hey, how you doing?" You can say, "Fine." But this morning's question is different. It's far more important. And I will acknowledge it's far more awkward. And I don't want you to answer this morning. I want you to go home with this question, and I want you to allow the searchlight of truth and a vulnerability in your own heart that says, "God, if you hit a pressure spot that I need to change, I'm ready to change." How's your heart? No one can answer it for you. You and God. How's your heart? Our Father, Paul said it well, there's no condemnation, and this question isn't to bring condemnation to any of us. This question is to bring awareness to the difference you can make. If we say we believe the truths about you, if we say we believe that you were a God who was personal and that you promised to us and provide for us eternal life, and Father, those truths ought to be game changers in the way in which we live in life. Joy-filled, hope-filled, peace-filled, contentment-filled. And if those things aren't a reality for us, then we are just trained people, not transformed lives. So help us answer the question correctly. How is our heart? In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Have a great afternoon. Mother's Day next Sunday. Don't forget.